Hello all, and welcome to episode 37 of Enterprise Tech India Unplugged. And today we have a big participation from Nishant from IBS, Gautam from Landmark, Venkat from Aqua Connect, and of course Kumaran from Tiny Magic, who is our chief mentor and CTO. And the topic which we have chosen today to discuss, which is, I guess it is hard enough to talk about, is security in the enterprise. And what has been happening of late in the enterprise world. There have been ransomware attacks. There have been vulnerabilities exposed. Lot of software organizations, including open source, have come under scrutiny for issues in security, and they keep on coming. And of course, bugs, security bugs, are sort of a side effect of programming. It's not something which is avoidable. What I want to know, Kumaran, is what is it that you fear the most in terms of what is actually happening in the enterprise? Is it completely avoidable, or the IT teams are not just taking it too seriously? That's why we have all these issues.
I think it's okay. So it's kind of interesting. Vulnerabilities, right? My first job was writing antivirus software. So that's where I actually started. Okay, so my first job used to write firmware at a hardware level. So at that time, that is in 93, boot sector viruses were the most popular ones, right? So you put a floppy in, the virus comes through the boot floppy. Okay. So, and usually it was signature based. So when we wrote a software, we look for activity. So if a certain set of activity happens, then I know that there is a possible virus here and we shut down the entire system, right? So usually antivirus softwares have to be installed, then you put a floppy and then you do it, right? But if the virus gets in, you're done. In our case, what will happen is we used to have a hardware card, and our antivirus software is actually a firmware. It will run from the firmware card. So we were in a hardware company. So before the boot up starts, we'll take control of the system. And if there are, like, for example, it's a very simple thing. If you find that an application is trying to write to the boot sector, we'll immediately stop. I don't see any reason why somebody should try to write to the boot sector, because data is always in the data sector itself. Okay. So we'll stop it right then. And then we'll kind of give a warning to the end user, like, see, this is a anomaly activity. And then what we will do is we have signatures again. Virus signatures will be there. We'll scan to see if anything is there. Okay. That's where I started. So my first job was that. Okay. But then I switched off into application programming and I moved. Okay. But it kind of this. So my boss used to say at that time, he said, this security thing is a robber police game. Okay. Some days robbers will win. Some days police will win. And this game will go on forever. Okay, that is what is happening. Okay, if I can say no more robbery will happen, that is the stupidest police department that can exist. Okay, or if the robbers give up saying that the police are so strong that I won't do anything, then the fun is also lost. Okay, so that's not going to happen, because there is too much of incentive to rob. Okay, so it is basically like, now these things have evolved and it makes it better. Now, and the nature of the crimes also changed. So when CCTVs came, the biggest challenge was, did it reduce crime rates? Yes, it did. But the other problem that it has created is, or let's say there were, like, you could identify people, right? Okay. So now, previously, whatever identification happens, now that has got lost. Now people have become, the robbers have started masking their identity also. Now it's become trickier. So previously you could get information about the crime perpetrator, how he looked and things like that. Now you can't get that also. So now what has happened is the number of crimes have decreased, but when a crime happens, it's become harder to solve, because the perpetrators have become very good at it. So now the crime depth has gone higher. So as long as a crime doesn't happen, you are good. But when it happens, it's a serious crime. Okay, so it kind of goes on to the things like, it's a little unfortunate. Like previously, when the rape laws were not that strict, there were more rapes happening. Now it has become stricter. They kill the rape victim, which is even more worse, right?
Yes.
So now it's created a different kind of a problem. It's like Cobra effect, which we talked different episodes ago.
Right.
So now instead of just a rape, you have a rape followed by a murder also. It's just crazy, right? That doesn't mean we can reduce the loss. But I'm telling you, it's just that when you increase the system, the complexity also increases. Now it's become even more harder. So it's just that previously 100 people were committing the crime. Now only 30 will commit it. But those 30 will be so hard to stop.
Right, right. So in your view, is there a balance which can be achieved in this robber police game? Is there a balance which can be achieved where at least most of the time robbers don't succeed? Because sometimes they will succeed, as you said. But at least the frequency or... the things which they're doing is, in fact, what if you look at the Microsoft report, the nation state attacks actually have increased across the world. So this is not specific to any particular nation state, but the nation state attacks between countries where the governments are actually attacking the facilities or industries of the other government, other country. How do you see that? Is that now, because now it has become a weapon rather than just being malicious and people, because earlier what used to happen is people will just come in, delete your data, and this is just destruction. They call it the wipers, right? And they will just come in, delete the data, just cause mayhem and just be mischievous, right? This is no particular benefit, right? Then came in this ransomware. It's a come encrypt your data. If you give us this money in Bitcoin, and then we will unlock this data, right? So that is the second thing. Now this thing is, now people want to steal technology, people want to steal trade secrets, right? So it's not that trade secret stealing is something new, but in the IT world, getting through the network, because everything is now connected, it has become much more easier and much more profitable for people to invest in stealing somebody's technology rather than going through ransomware and doing just general mayhem.
So I think for the enterprise and nationwide thing, it's hard for me to visualize something around that, right? I think what has happened is, it's not one lone wolf hacker or a lone wolf virus developer. I think we have kind of matured. Just like we have an enterprise, right?
It's organized crime now.
It's become organized crime. And that's the scary part. Now, the organized crime can be run by a private entity or a government entity. It doesn't matter. It's organized. Now, what does organized mean? Now, if you remember the solar winds, right? I really went deep into that just out of curiosity, right? Mm-hmm. And when I looked at it deeply, it's actually pretty exciting. Normally, and virus is something like, I have a program or a piece of code which I sneak into a network, okay? How do I sneak it into a network? It is usually a Trojan mechanism in which there is a popular application. In that population, I patch it as a part of that and send it into it. So when this application goes, it will go into there. So the evolution of security, what has happened is, either during release, when the software is released, or when the software comes into an enterprise, the antivirus software start looking for signatures and scanning for that. And that's how they kind of did it. Okay. Now, this is the equivalent of the rape law, which I was talking about. Okay, now enterprises have enacted it, so they are like, cool, you know what, I put this law, things are done, okay, we are covered, kind of a thing. Okay, there is a sense of lacunae, right? Because I put this virus security things, we are all safe. But what has happened here is actually very interesting. The hackers did not add any extra library or extra code. Okay. They went to the existing source code. Okay. They went to the GitHub. They didn't even write a new function within an existing function. So you can't even catch it by the function name. Right? There is no new function like open window or open backdoor, send data, nothing like that is there. These are the checks which were produced. Okay. Now they didn't do that. So there is an init function.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not exaggerating. It's actually an init function. In that init function, they do something like do basic checks. An innocuous function like that. That was added.
Mm-hmm.
Validate input like this. It's just that validate input has some few extra characters. So that function is there. So when somebody does a code scan or a code review, like let's say it comes for a code review as a manager, right? Or somebody. Now I am doing code review of hundreds of codes, right? So I'm looking at it. Oh, okay. He's validating some extra parameter. You look at that and say, okay, fine. Gone. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
It went through. How did this happen?
Social engineering. This is social engineering.
Beyond social engineering. They made somebody come type that code in and check it into GitHub, which means that person is a developer in your team.
Yes.
Now, is that whether that guy was paid money or somebody in family was held to ransom so that person did it? We don't know what. Okay. Now, this is. I am speechless. I don't know how to handle this. Okay. Which is very worrisome. Right. If it happens at this level, and if it and I'm just lucky that a lot of people don't know this.
Mm-hmm.
And imagine the amount of developers that we have. Now, how long is it going to take for me? I don't even know whether I should tell this publicly. Anyway, how long is it going to take, right? Okay, one good thing is not many people listen to us. So it's okay.
That is good. It's okay.
How long is it going to take for somebody to figure out what Citibank projects are running or what ICICI projects are running?
Yes.
Right? Or what e-commerce portal all of us are working in?
Right.
Where our dev team is? Who are the developers? Okay. And I kind of just put a gun to their family member's head and then say, go deploy this code next time you do a check-in.
Right.
It's so simple. How much money do I have to spend?
Yeah.
25K. So today is the world where in India, you can get people murdered in UP for 50,000 rupees.
Right.
Probably this is a 10K investment that I have to do.
Yeah.
To get that code in. And I get that done, I can have somebody, some very big conglomerate in the fist of my hands for 50,000 rupees of investment.
Right. Right.
And so, they will pay through their nose.
Right. So let us listen to the people. Yeah.
It's scary.
Who are trying to build applications. And starting with you, Venkat, I know. Your application is used by a large number of people and some of them are not very tech savvy. What are you doing to sort of secure your application to prevent something like what Kumaran just described happen? Of course, you have to protect your developers, but... but
Black Hat Commandos for all developers.
Z category is security.
Z category for all developers.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe you have to do that if you're working on a critical project.
That's what happens in defense projects, actually.
Yeah. Roja, right? Remember?
Yeah.
Hey, I'm adding from Kumaran this one. Actually, it is, it's not exaggerating. No, it is really scary. So whatever he is saying. And so it is, now I'm thinking, what should I do to avoid this kind of, interference to make sure improve the security. Like now only I'm thinking like what I can do. So before that, I never thought of.
What Kumaran described is probably some of the things are law and order related. we have not much control over it. But what we have, let us focus on what we can control, right? Of course, we need to make sure that our people follow safe practices to make sure they are secure at home or wherever they are working, right? But besides that, from technology perspective, what can you do or what you are doing today to prevent sort of Trojan getting inside your code itself?
We are trying to avoid the third party or like open source program as much as possible to avoid so this kind of security induces. Like other than that, actually we are not doing much. If you say like exactly, so what we are if you say like what we are doing for securing your code, and actually we are not doing a lot actually, since it is a startup company. It is only 4 or 5 members are actually writing our core software. We are not spending much of resources on the security. If you say exactly. And going way forward, and I might need to look into I might take some advice from Kumar on how we can improve our security in terms of traffic and the code and etc.
So Nishant, do you have any recommendation to Venkat what he can do to secure his applications from your experience?
Even I was thinking about the from my experience.
His hand on his forehead answers the question. Yeah. Don't worry, even I'm also like that. Okay.
Yeah, from my experience, from what I generally see is security is always in the software development also. Security is also generally an afterthought, because all developers, including architects, are actually not much worried about security when they develop the system. And once they develop the system, and we think we have a security testing team and it's their role, and sometimes security testing team, we are not even sure whether this piece of code or this module that we developed is a security testing needed candidate. Then only we will give it to the security testing team for test it. And when the security testing team tests this, this problem is when they identify some issues this Tomcat version is not this, has some vulnerability, we need to upgrade, and this thing has some problem. And since at that time we see it as a very an effortful task, upgrading the Tomcat at that point to a later version and checking the regression back and all, we always take an exception. We have a general tendency or a mindset why they are saying this Tomcat version would create a vulnerability, then is it really a mandatory, the general tester developer kind of defense mindset, right? So I think there is a still, I'm saying from my experience, okay? I'm not sure whether this is the practice happening in the oral industry and all. And my point is still there is a huge gap in the architect's mindset or the developer mindset to think about this, the importance of security. Because security, if we really look at the points that Kumaran mentioned, then I think that is might be an unsolvable problem. That is a different case. At least we should have a bare minimum kind of things to make sure that our code is secure enough to run in a production environment which is accessible by, or the software is accessible to an end user. So in that point, when Venkat mentioned about that things, the third parties things and all, I was thinking when we might have code scanner and all to identify the code level vulnerability. But how about if we add so many third party library and all, do we have any tool or mechanism to identify the vulnerability in that code? Any idea, Deepak or Kumaran, from your experience?
I think it's actually a tough thing. So
actually
if you look at this, right, I think Nishant, one thing, it's kind of interesting compared to our previous discussion, right? Something else happened. So this is why I call the weakness in architecture as an anti-fractal. It keeps happening again and again. Now, did you just notice, you said that at the end of a development, we get to the security team. So just like performance, yeah. Security also becomes an afterthought.
Correct.
Which means the security actually comes in the quality attributes pillar. Now, that pillar should be considered before the start of the program, not at the end of an application development. So that is kind of an, again, an architectural. I'm just connecting it to the previous
discussion. Yeah. Yeah. So,
and again, the security aspect, like when we say like this PCA, DSS, those kind of, some kind of security testing, actually we are doing purely for taking certification. Like just for taking certification, we are doing, or we are never read about security. Like for example, if we are dealing with credit card, then the PCI DSS kind of certification and the total requirements mentioned in the PCI DSS, external auditor or the internal auditor will ensure that we are touching those 12, requirements that this certification mandates. So I think there also we are doing it just for the sake of certification. I think we are not much worried about whether our customer card data is that much secure in our system. And we believe, like, when we ensure that when we have those 12 things in place, that everything is safe.
I think let me talk about some things which I have kind of thought of, right? So again, security is a journey, right? You can keep spending millions of dollars and still not be secure. Okay. So that's a given. So it's like, so we have to kind of balance the trade-off between how much security am I going to give? And does that, so technically, if you want to secure everything, you should give one black cat commando to every developer, or even one black cat commando, is it enough? We don't know. Okay. Still, we might not know. Okay. They might come with three commandos now. Okay. So, now, if the black hat commando is compromised, what will you do?
Yes.
That's also possible, right? You are assigned a standard black hat commando. So that commando will, family will be, again, you will get compromised. Okay. So this is an interesting thing that happens. Okay. So one, like, I'll tell what I have done so far. Now, one thing which I did is there is a very small 25K investment that I have done. Okay. Where I did a pure black box vulnerability test of my servers and application. Okay, as a startup, I can spend that money. I did that. So I can say at a bare minimal thing, somebody cannot just walk into my server and do something. Okay, so the server is, that way it is covered. Okay, so we have that thing checked from a server, SSH ports open, close open, fundamental base security. Okay, so as a startup, I can do that. I've done it. The second thing is increase awareness. That's something that can be done. It doesn't take money. It just takes some amount of effort. Increase awareness from two fronts. What are the possible attacks that's happening? What are the weaknesses in my system that I have? Understand that. What would be the impact if somebody breaks through? So for example, in my case, the nature of my business is I don't have too much of I don't have any PII information. For GDPR compliance, I took that strategy. How is the best way to save data, to keep data safe?
Don't give data.
Don't give data, correct? So I don't have PII information. I just have names, okay? Who are they? I have, for example, in my case, Nishant, Venkat, and Gautam are there as users in my application. But beyond their name, nobody will be able to trace it back to them. It could be any Tom, Dick, and Harry. It doesn't make a difference. It just happens to be Gautam, Venkat, and Nishant. But beyond that, I don't have anything because I wanted to be GDPR compliant. What is the best way? I remove the PII, no more. I am GDPR compliant. Okay. So if I don't store data, I don't have. So that's one approach which I took. Okay. So if you don't store data, you don't have to safeguard it. Okay. So that's a very easy, not an easy, it's a simple solution. Maybe it's not that easy because you have to get a little more creative. Now, the challenge is if I have to connect to the end users or do something about that, I don't have a mechanism. Okay. So it's currently manual. So I manually will look at this application. And so there is a case in which people can request for whatever they have done. So when they request it, right, that will come to my mail ID. then in my mail, I will say which group, which user, and then get that person's email, and then I will forward it. So it's like an air gap that I have created between the personal information and this. So this is a manual process that I have done. Probably later I can now do it into a Power Automate if possible. Okay. So that's one way of doing it. So I have moved, like, for example, that PII information, I can move it now. Now that I've gone to Office 365, that PII information, I will store it inside Office 365. Mapping Nishant to this thing will be under Office 365, which means I can take all the goodness of Office 365 security. I don't have to build that, invest that cost into my application. That's another strategy. So move those data to a secured place. Don't store it with yourself. Do what is bare minimal needed so that you don't have to build. It's like the equivalent in the real world is, what do we do to keep our valuables safe?
Get a locker.
You get a locker. Correct? So can you do that in the enterprise? Sure, you can. It's the same pattern that you follow. So what all critical data you have, don't spend time and energy and effort in that. Store it somewhere else where people offer security. That is their core business. Move it over there. Okay, so then it becomes a lot more easier. That's another thing. So once you're kind of aware, so you're basically shifting the risk to somebody else, and you're, and that costs lesser rather than you building your own walls. Then it's about increasing awareness of what's happening outside. So the recently, one of the things I was discussing with a teammate is, this is actually a big challenge for the new age development. Now, I won't use third-party software. Cannot be done nowadays.
You have to use.
You have to use. There is no way out. Even if you go with Microsoft, right? It still uses open source packages. Okay. Now, the problem with open source packages, nobody takes liability for that. It is only you who are liable. If you use AngularJS, if you use ReactJS, if you use Flutter, Google or Facebook or XYZ developer is not liable. Only me as the user is liable for it. Okay. And is there any mobile application which doesn't use any of these frameworks?
All of them.
All of them use it. Okay. Now, the biggest challenge is this. That package uses a sub package. That uses a sub package. That uses a sub package. I will do an NPM get of the high level package only. I don't even know what are all the packages that's coming along with it. Okay. And recently I learned from my developer is that there is a very small piece of code that is getting introduced. You know what it does? Very simple. It will take all the cookie information. If all of you who are familiar with mobile programming, right? There is a web storage each application has, which is on the client side browser. Essentially, it's a key value pair of all the important information for that user. Okay. That software does nothing. It just takes that key value pair and sends it out to a third party. That's all. Very simple. Now, Nishant and Venkat being developers, right? If you have this information of any mobile application out there, what power does that give you?
So it's giving you the token, right?
From the token, what power does it give you?
It gives you the, you can take out the mobile.
Anything. It gives you ultimate power. You can do anything that you want.
Yeah.
Now, if that user happens to be an admin, which is the Twitter case, right? Somebody went and posted on behalf of somebody, right? That happened. You can spoof that user.
Yeah. The CEO I know that this Twitter himself got spooked on that.
Yeah. So I know that this is a vulnerability. Okay. I'm aware of it. I don't know what I'm going to do about it. But this is something which I need to keep at the back of my mind. Now, how does it help? So when I'm putting something in a web store, I will tell myself, better be careful. This is dangerous. I don't make an assumption. Again, best way, if you want to secure data, don't store it.
If I don't put it in the web store, nobody can take it. That is, when I say web store, I mean in the browser, right? If I don't store it in the browser cache, nobody can steal it. So what is there? Be careful about that. Then I can start picking additionally on. So probably later I will kind of have, if something is going to make a call from my mobile app, I'll watch for something like that. I don't know. But this is so actually the multiple.
What you mentioned about credentials, actually. So this is actually also one of the case studies shared by Microsoft in what they did for securing their applications. One of the things which they said was, the biggest vulnerability inside code is when you store credentials inside your code. So because you need access to different services, you need access to AWS, S3, storage, whatever, Azure, all these have some tokens which need to be passed on in the code, right? And what most the hackers and the crackers, what they do is, they just go to GitHub and they scan the code, look for credentials, right? So that is the easiest way in for anybody to get inside your service, right? So if I get token to your storage, right, I can just go directly to your S3 storage, right? Because you put it in your code, I got access to your code, I got simply your token. Your code is on GitHub. Now GitHub actually has implemented certain things that if you, it actually does a scan now. So if you actually store anything on GitHub and it has credentials inside it, it actually gives you feedback that you should not be doing this and all. In fact, I put some random code there and it is, my code is not really that important, but it gave me feedback that you have certain things. Over and above that, what they've done is they have built their own, I think in Azure DevOps, these extensions are available for credential scanning. That when, just like code scanning, they will do a credential scan, that they will scan the code and figure out if there is any credential which is kept inside the code. So they will, basically the build will fail. So they are stopping it at that level. It says the code itself will not be built if there is any credentials inside it. Right. And for a large application, they can have credentials to the tune of maybe 2000 credentials. So when I say credentials, they include tokens to different services, all those things, right? Passwords to all those areas, right? So that is one area which I believe all developers should have. They should basically make sure they get rid of credentials inside their code.
Actually, that's a very good point. In fact, I had made that mistake, I think 2-3 years ago. So there was some thing, and it was actually, it was not, there was something else that was there. So it was actually nothing. In GitHub, okay, what I had done is in a wiki page, right? I had actually kind of, so this is internal. Okay, so there is a private key, which I said, you know, use this for doing something like that as a part of the instructions. Okay. So my team member pointed out to me, no, don't put it on the wiki page because it's open to scanning. And second, make your, okay, so quick tips will be like taking off from what Deepak said, GitHub, it repository. And sometimes we have a lot of configurations, right? Where is the source? What is the source things? You have a lot of information in the config files. Okay. So don't put it on GitHub. After deployment, go and put it on, change that, put that entry on the actual server. Whether it's a test server or dev server or production server, do it there instead of doing it in GitHub. That is one thing. And the second thing is, enable two-factor authentication of your GitHub repositories. So that actually just increases
the credentials part. I just want to add that there are now tools available from most cloud providers to store credentials separately. Right. So there's, I think in Azure, they call it Key Vault, AWS. I don't know what the name is.
KMS.
Key management service, right? So they have these tools available to store the credentials, and most of the build and tools like Jenkins or Azure DevOps, their pipeline tools actually, wherever you need to pass credentials, they can give you parameterize it and put it in a separate encrypted location, right? So you can use the KMS or you can use the encrypted locations within those build servers also, so that you don't get exposed even when you're building it or deploying it. You don't have to store those credentials in an open text format. Gautam, we didn't hear from you anything which from the strategic perspective, what you're thinking about, how do you secure your infrastructure? How do you secure your applications? What do you get from this conversation we just had?
From the IT security, since our stack is more into Microsoft, that is almost like, okay, we have given the entire security risk outsourced to Microsoft, right? So any deployment that we do into Dynamics, it is all in, taken care by Microsoft. So we don't actually get into the security point of view. Mm-hmm. But it also, because our website, the e-commerce website is not Microsoft. That's a non-Microsoft website. It's not from Dynamics Commerce, but it's a third party, right? That's where all the security risk that you are talking about comes into mind. And it is actually kind of a bit scary, because it is actually taking in customers' credit card details and we are making transactions, right? Now, we haven't focused much because the website has just launched a few months back, but we will have to start focusing more into the website security. But I would also like to disagree to the point, Nishant also told this point about the certification, right? Mm-hmm. Though you get certified by a PCI DSS, if you evaluate a PCI DSS, that would have been version 3 or version 4, right? So that would have been almost done 2-3 years back. Mm. And it is almost like a continuous journey, like what Kumaran just explained. So right now, sitting at on March 27th, you don't know what is the new vulnerability that we are getting exposed to, right? And though you get certified, it doesn't mean that you're totally foolproof, right? So you will have some kind of...
You get COVID vaccination doesn't mean you won't get COVID.
Exactly. Exactly.
You have to get the booster dose.
No, this actually brings in a lot of thought. I was just thinking, okay, what is that we need to do? I just took note of the vulnerability testing that we should immediately do on our websites. And also, yes, we will have to look at from a security standpoint on how we could have a secured data for our customers.
So there is one more exercise, which actually, interestingly, in the case study which Microsoft shared, was the red team, blue team. This is a concept for handling security issues while you are developing the software, right? So so they have this red team, blue team concept. They will conduct these exercises, the red team, blue team exercise, where red team's job is to come and break the system.
Okay.
Blue team's job is to protect the system, right? So what you have to do is, the composition of the red team has to be, one is you get some good hackers, right? Other is you get some people from the inside, people who know where the dead bodies are buried, as they say, right? So you get them into a red team and say, now your job is to break this system, right? And they have a very interesting concept. It says, you actually, if you get in, right? So we don't want you to bring the system down. You just have to prove that you got in, right? So they have to visibly show to somebody that you do it. So what they did is, so if you get into the system, you will turn the thing upside down. So the display will go upside down. That means you have got in, right? So this is an exercise which they use, where the red team will come in and they will break in and says, how quickly can you get in? And so once the people who really know the service inside out, people who have developed the software, said, okay, I know how to get in. So they will expose it and they'll say, okay, turn the page upside down. Or they will add some comments in the field. So if you click on that, they're also very creative. So if you click on that, that means you have hit that vulnerability, and they will, that vulnerability, that it will go and log a bug inside the system and says, okay, you hit this vulnerability so many times, and this is the bug for that. So that is an exercise which they internally do to prove again and again that this system is secure. So, and sometimes it is very embarrassing. So they, what they do is after the event, they will call and say whose code got broken where. So nobody wants to be there, right? But it is some part of it also has to be handled in the culture part, because it can be very embarrassing to do such an event, right? And when your code breaks and you're called into question, it is the handling of that situation also requires some finesse, right? You cannot, it says, just because your code break tomorrow, you are out of the company. You cannot run companies like that, right?
It's just like body shaming, you cannot do code shaming. No?
You have to do shaming sensitively, I would say. Right. So this is some things which I remember from the case study. Is there anything else, Kumaran, which you?
I think what you said is actually interesting. I think probably I kind of do that because I'm not in the dev team, right? I have just some exam. So sometimes I will just think, if this has to break, what will happen, kind of a thing. But then you gave a good structure called red team, blue team, right? So we can actually call it a red-blue game. And each of us can play it at the scope that we can. Right. So maybe it is something like, for example, Venkat, it's a startup, right? So let's say you do a monthly, not even monthly. So let's say you can't afford it. Quarterly, we will do a red team, blue team game. You'll sit for 1 hour. You don't have to write code. So the red team will actually ask questions. You know, I can do this. I can do this. I can do this. What can you do? It's like a debate, right? I'll ask a question. Hey, I will go and run this query. What will you do? Either they have to say, I agree that I'm done, or they will say, no, we can. You don't really, I'm just telling you a simpler version of that red team, blue team game. You really don't have to write a code. You will say, I'll just run this code to get that data. Can you stop me or not? So the blue team will just answer it. So they can either come prepared, or you have 15 minute preparation time. The red team will form their questions, give it. So you can play a red team, blue team game. It can be quarterly, monthly, depending on how much ever we can afford. If you can afford a lot of things, then we will have a code and do it. But at least you can have a verbal duel, right? Like that debates that we have seen in those things. Like that we could do. I think that's a interesting way of doing
it. This is an internal thing. Of course, you can hire a penetration testing team itself, right? So they can, I think this is a very common practice, I mean, in enterprises, where on periodic basis, they will come and hire a penetration testing team who will do a sort of a general scan and do all those things. But that is a sort of a black box approach, right? They don't know what is inside. They will just come in and attack and see. But red team, blue team is much more effective because they know what is inside your code, right? So that is much more effective.
So the team which I had hired, they also do white box, but then I didn't take that one.
More expensive. Primary,
it's more expensive, but actually that was not the deal breaker. The deal breaker is basically I have to sit with them and explain what my code is.
Yeah, exactly. So that's why it is better.
I need to have documentation to explain it, right? I don't have great documentation. I cannot just throw some code at them and say, you look at it. It has thousands of lines of code.
Right.
How will they even review something like that, right? So I don't have somebody to spend time with them to explain it. And if I just get them, they will read something and they will do something. It won't be good value for money. So the thing that I can't spend that much of time to enable them or enlighten them on my code is a thing. But again, it's like those thing, right? Now I have done that. Somebody outside my company knows my code also.
Right, right.
I'm outside all NDA and all.
Yes.
Right? But then they know that also. That's another thing which had kind of, I hadn't done that, but this black box testing was pretty much non-intrusive. I just had to give them the URL and then they will do it. And I just have to tell them a time frame, because when they are doing the testing, right,
yes,
my users shouldn't get affected. So that's something like that. Gautam, I can share with you the context of who had helped me later.
So I think this is a good conclusion to the discussion. I think everybody has something to go back and think about.
One thing
Yes, go ahead.
Deepak Kumar, one thing I would like to hear from your side is, like, especially when we have a startup or a product company running in a SaaS model. And when it finally comes into an investment point of view based on the ROI on different aspects like the development architects or this insert testing, NFR testing, security testing, is there in general tendency that we should compromise more on this security testing? Because when it comes to security testing, actually we are quite it's unpredictable. Like we don't know whether the vulnerability can happen or not. So based on that, do we need to invest more on this only for the security, and just to ensure whether I need to invest this much dollar to ensure that our product is so much secure, or I should invest that into some other matter which is quite predictable and I can foresee.
The answer to that is in the risk factor, right? So it is also a place where risk analysis has to be done. What is the cost of not doing it, right? Okay. Because it's easy to figure out how much downtime. See, for example, what is simple? Some risk is very clear. It says if you are not compliant with GDPR and something security happens, how much money you have to pay, right? Because there are fines directly related to those things, right? If you have a credit card breach, what is the fines you have to pay? Who all you have to disclose? What is the cost of doing all that part, right? That should decide how much investment you should make into security, right? So if that part is clear, the investment will come. There is nobody will ask those questions. It says, okay, it's like, if you had some, nobody asks questions today that to achieve GDPR compliant, we have to spend this much money. Nobody questions that, right? Because if you're working in that market, you have to comply. There is no option, right? So that is the approach I would take. Go after risk and say, what is the risk of not doing it rather than what is the benefit of doing this, right?
Yeah.
So that is the approach. Yeah.
I would say it's a kind of, this, whatever we are talking about is a overlap between your quality pillar and a BTS pillar. So it's more a BTS pillar question rather than a quality pillar or a IT environment. The implementation happens in that, but the decision making will happen in the BTS pillar. So which means, like, let's say as a owner, as a solution owner or architect, whatever you want to call yourself, we have to do an impact analysis. Say, this is the cost of not doing it. Now you present it to the business stakeholder and say, now you take a call whether you want this eliminated or not. That will answer that question. It's a, I'm okay to have this. Great. Okay. So in my company's case, I am taking that call because I am both the business owner also. Now, if something happens, there is a public, we are not that big. That brand is not that much big. It's just a shaming thing, right? But other than that, there's no serious loss that happens. If somebody breaks down, my system will be down, and I'm okay with that, right? But maybe if it is it something like people will lose complete faith in me as an organization or me as a solution? And is that very critical to my business? I don't think so. Like, for example, if the application is down for 1 week, Nishant will still consider me worth looking at. Okay. But if it is going to be a, let's say something like a banking application or WhatsApp for that matter, if WhatsApp is down for 5 days, then I'll be seriously worried, especially if I'm doing some business with WhatsApp. So there are two parts. One, make it easy for the decision maker by telling him what is the actual impact. And if you can give it in terms of dollar value, it's much better. If you just say 100 dB of data will be compromised or the system will be down for 5 hours, it's little hard for them to connect. But if you connect it to that, you know, you are going to lose of $1 million. Okay.
Yeah.
Now you have to invest 100K in security. I think the case answers itself. The answer is there in the problem statement itself.
So, all right. Venkat, you want to add something?
Yeah. Actually, like, as you after you guys are mentioning, actually we are following a couple of steps, but knowingly, like this is a critical for security. So far, as you said, credentials, actually we never stored in our GitHub, and because whenever we are and the credentials we are using for development server and production server itself, it's a different. Though we are not storing the credentials, so this kind of steps we are measuring it. And as you say, authorization and authentication, we are not handling it ourselves, because that is a very critical and lot of steps to follow. And we are using the Firebase for that matter. We are using the Firebase authentication, so we don't need to do much of effort. And one more thing is, as you said, wherever it's possible, and we can use best solutions out there if there is any. And we are also not storing any critical information in our DB directly. So that's how we can use make sure even someone is steals data, since it is encrypted, he cannot decrypt without the key. Security, actually we are following it. Only thing is, as you said, we are not giving the much importance to security as of now, and so in way forward, so we need to consider a lot of details as you guys are discussing it here. Thank you.
So I think the conclusion is clear. All of us need to look at security. Make sure risk analysis is done at the building phase, at the decision making phase, at the technical decision or business decision making phase. Make sure that the architects are involved in analyzing that risk and giving input to the investment decision makers to be able to invest that. And of course, we discussed good measures what you can take, things like credential scans while doing build, doing penetration testing, making sure. In fact, I just want to add, there are a lot of tools available which do vulnerability scanning for open source also. So, and these are open source tools, and they are, so you can put them in your build process to make sure that any open source vulnerabilities are not carried forward, because they have increasingly become the unknown factor. While a lot of people assume that open source means everybody can see it, but everybody's problem becomes nobody's problem also sometimes. So and people don't fix it. And then a case in point is OpenSSL, right? OpenSSL has vulnerabilities for so many years, right? And that the source code has been available for so long. So it is not necessary just because it is open source, the vulnerabilities will be fixed all the time. So with that, thank you everyone for your time, and hope all of you become more aware of the security in your environment and fix the issues before they become embarrassing for your enterprise. So thank you, and keep listening and keep subscribing, and see you next time. Thank you.